Hey everyone, Pastor John here with another Dive Deeper during Holy Week. We're spending time every single day diving into the Word of God and looking at what Jesus did, what he taught, the events of the week that led up to his crucifixion and resurrection. Yesterday we spent time and we talked about how Jesus cursed a fig tree, how his authority was challenged, and how he sent the money changers out of the temple. The lessons that we learned yesterday really showed us that our lives must be in an abiding relationship with Christ, so that they can produce fruit that would demonstrate, confirm, and prove the proclamation that we make, that we are a believer, that we are one of his disciples, that we're a Christian. Today, we're gonna learn a little bit more about that, something that reinforces that same message. We kind of see a consistent theme in Christ's teaching. So what happened on Tuesday? On Tuesday, Jesus is heading out with his disciples. They're heading toward the Mount of Olives, and his disciples see the tree that he cursed on Monday, and the tree has withered, it's dead. And when they look at it and they see that it's dead, they kind of look at it in wonder. They're kind of in awe at what had happened and surprised that Jesus, not that Jesus cursed the tree, but that the tree was dead, that it actually like responded to the curse that Jesus made. And Jesus, you know, he kind of looks at his disciples and he tells them, you know, if you have faith the size of a mustard seed, not only can you do what I did with the tree, but you can say to this mountain, you know, cast yourself into the sea and it would happen. You know, he continues often in his teaching to, and in his ministry to really, you know, kind of coach the disciples to try and address their lack of faith, because often they just seem to be surprised at the power. They seem to be surprised at, you know, the miracles that he does. And to me, this is something that just like really stands out to me. Like these men, they were with Jesus every single day for 3.5 years. The Bible tells us in John that if someone had written down everything that Jesus did, there would not be enough volumes in the world to capture it all. And these men, they witnessed all of it. They saw it firsthand. And yet, despite seeing all of this, they still struggled with faith often. I mean, think about what the disciples witnessed Jesus do. They saw him heal the sick. They saw him, you know, make the blind see, to heal crippled. They saw him raise people from the dead. They saw him walk on water. They saw him, you know, feed thousands upon thousands of people twice in scripture. Not only did they see Jesus do these miracles, but they went empowered by Christ to go out and do ministry on their own. And they also performed miracles. And yet, despite all of this, they still struggled with their faith. And Jesus would often say, "You of little faith." So what's the lesson for us in this? One, I think there is some encouragement that if these men who witnessed all of this, who were with Jesus all the time for 3.5 years, if they still struggled with their faith, then of course there are going to be times when we struggle with ours. Of course, there are going to be times when our faith feels weak, when doubt creeps in, when, you know, the challenges of life, you know, really seem to just like battle us and begin to undermine our faith and introduce doubt and concern or fear or worry. But I think it's important that we don't allow this encouragement to kind of grow into complacency, as it might be easy to look at the disciples and one, be jealous of the interaction that they had with Christ, but then think, well, if they couldn't do it, neither can I, so I'm not even going to try. And that is not what we should do. Rather, what we should do is look at the disciples and realize that if these men who spent their lives with Christ for 3.5 years every single day, if they still struggled with faith, how much more important is our walk with the Lord to ensure that our faith remains strong? How much more do we need to invest in our relationship with God to make sure that we remain strong? What do I mean by that? I mean, how much more do we need to pray to God every day? How much more do we need to be reading our Bibles? How much more do we need to be worshiping God? How much more do we need to be engaging with him, seeking him time after time and in all the time to make sure that he is first in our life, but also to make sure that our faith remains strong, so that in those moments when, you know, the devil might try to attack us with doubt or worry, or, you know, a circumstance might come in and try to undermine our faith, then we can stand firm, as the Bible says, because we remain firm in Christ. So I think first, that is our lesson. That's a lesson that we need to learn from this, you know, interaction that Jesus had with his disciples. And I challenge you to make sure that you're taking ownership of your walk with God, that you are investing in it. You're not relying on other people and their relationship with God, but you are walking with the Lord personally, individually, intimately, every single day, all day. So that's the first thing that I want to talk about on this Tuesday of Holy Week. Next, we need to look at what Jesus taught on that day. And you find it in Matthew chapter 23, and it's an address to the Pharisees. It says it's called the seven woes. And, you know, he literally brings out these woes against the Pharisees, really judging them and condemning them really for their own self-righteousness, because they were hypocrites. They were looking at themselves and thinking they were clean. They were thinking they were righteous, when inside they were nothing more than hypocrites. And he says, dead men's bones. Let me read you the words from Matthew 23. I encourage you to read the whole chapter today, but just we'll read a couple verses near the end, starting in verse 25. It says, "Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you clean the outside of the cup and the plate, but inside they are full of greed and self-indulgence. You blind Pharisee, first clean the inside of the cup and the plate, that the outside may also be clean. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you are like whitewashed tombs, which outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and uncleanliness. So you also outwardly appear righteous to others, but within you are full of hypocrisy and lawlessness." This is a lesson, and certainly as we read through the Gospels and study them, we see kind of this conflict that Jesus has with the Pharisees, and we can begin to look at the Pharisees with our own kind of disdain, or our own anger or bitterness toward them. But I think in this we need to be careful, and we actually need to look at, where do we try to be righteous? Where do we wash clean on the outside, but inside we're nothing but filth and rot and hypocrisy? We're unclean and lawless. Or where do we make sure that we're beautiful on the outside, but the outside is nothing more than a whitewashed tomb, and inside we're filled with nothing but dead bones? We're decaying, we're rotten, because our righteousness isn't found in what we can do. Our righteousness isn't found in our own effort. Our righteousness is found in Christ, and that's the message that he is proclaiming. And that's why the Pharisees were so upset, and why Jesus was so much against them, is because the Pharisees were trying to find righteousness in their work and the law. And Christ is saying, listen, the only way to righteousness is through me. And it's because he bore our sin. He knew that he had come so that he would take our sin upon him and then exchange that sin for his righteousness. So I challenge you today to do a couple things. One, I want you to invest in your walk with the Lord. And in that investment, as you study his word, as you worship him, as you pray to him, as you talk with him all the time, let him show you where in your life you are relying on your own work, where you are finding yourself to be self-righteous, where you have pride, where maybe you're not going to him, where you haven't allowed him to come in and wash you clean from the inside. Because that's where transformation begins. That transformation starts on the inside. We must be washed clean from the inside out, changed from the inside out, so that through our relationship with God, going back to what we talked about yesterday, that relationship, our abiding relationship with God, is what enables us to produce fruit that confirms the proclamation of faith that we make when we say that we are a Christian. I hope that as you go through this and as you finish out this week, that you spend time doing that, especially as we anticipate Christ's crucifixion and his resurrection, which we'll talk about later this week. But I just encourage you, invest in your walk with the Lord. Study his word every single day. Ask him to show you where you need to grow in your walk with him, so that you can produce fruit, or that he will bring fruit out in your life because of your relationship with him. God bless you as you dive deeper into his word every day.